Welcome to Microsoft Mechanics. To help you meet the needs of your remote workers, I'm going to share with you recent updates that we've made to our managed Windows Virtual Desktop service in Azure that gives you a more efficient, productive, and secure approach to desktop virtualization. Now, we first will look at the new WVD admin portal, now in public preview, and how we've expanded the service around the globe, as well as additional security capabilities with service tags and more. So Windows Virtual Desktop is a desktop and app virtualization service running on Azure. And if you're new to Windows Virtual Desktop, check out our intro at aka.ms/WVD playlist. Now, to improve the admin experience, we've taken many of the tasks that were previously available across PowerShell and Azure Active Directory, as well as in our host pool provisioning resource manager templates, and we've brought all that into a single unified portal in Azure. Now, this results in some notable improvements to the admin experience for creating a host pool, managing app groups, role-based access controls, and also monitoring the service. Now, we're going to start first with creating a host pool of virtual machines. Now, this is the foundation for creating a dedicated workspace for your users to access published resources. Now, we'll do that first in the new WVD admin portal. We'll select create a host pool. That's going to give us a few options like the subscription and resource group and also our host pool name. Now, here is where we can select the location for the host pool's metadata to be stored in order to meet your performance and also data sovereignty needs. Now, I'll walk through the rest of the steps here as well. So we can select the host pool type, personal or pooled, and the load balancing algorithm, breadth or depth, which I'll talk to in a moment. Now, we can also create the VMs themselves. Now, in the past, we had to do this in the resource manager templates. Now we can do that right here. So we can go ahead and select our resource group, our region. This is where the VMs are running, different from our metadata selection we made earlier. The number of VMs that we want and the name prefix, the image that we're going to select from. In this case, I'm going to use the virtual desktops version, which allows for multi-session. And then we give a couple more details, also like the AD domain join account that we'll be using for automated domain join. Now here I can select the workspace that I want to assign to my host pool. So here I'm going to drop down the list of available workspaces. I'll select the one I want, 02 or 0302 WS. Then I'll click next. And you can also see that we can apply tags. Now this is important for identifying those VMs we log into them. So to add a tag, we can go ahead and add from the selection of dropdowns here. And you can see I've added a couple of tags, but I only need one tag in my case, so I'll delete and just leave the one tag. Once we've created all those different fields and filled those in, we'll go ahead and review and create and look at the different fields and parameters that we've entered in. And we can see everything that we've done there. And finally, when we're ready to create that host pool, we just hit review and create in the bottom left. So once you've provisioned your VMs, you can start building application groups and assigning users to apps and desktops in this workspace. Now, application groups are a collection of apps or the entire desktop from a host pool that you can assign to users and now even Azure Active Directory groups. And by the way, this was all only done via PowerShell until now. So here I'm going to go click into an application group. I'll select, in my case, the accounting apps group. And once I do that, you can see first the applications that I've assigned to the group, and I've done this all through the GUI, a couple of apps there. And the assignments, I can also assign not only the user level, as we can see here, but I can also assign groups. In my case, I've assigned the accountants group. So that's what you do for WVD apps and users, but let's look at our admin roles. So additionally, related to identity management, all of your role-based access controls that were previously only in Azure Active Directory can be managed here as well. So to do that, you go into a host pool. If you click on the host pool name, you can go into access control and you'll be able to see all of the roles that were assigned to this host pool. So here you can see everything from log analytics contributor, monitoring contributor, the owners, and also the WVD session host administrator, all assigned through RBAC. Further, we can also do more reporting through log analytics. So here, if I log into monitoring through log analytics, I can see the health of my entire Windows Virtual Desktop service through log analytics using Azure Monitor. Now, another area we've been working on is the foundation to scale out your virtual machines using Azure Automation. Now, you'll remember that we can scale out using breadth mode, which optimizes performance per user, or depth mode, which optimizes at a per VM utilization level, and you can use a combination of both modes if you'd like. Now, before I get into the demo itself, just to set some context here, the way to get this all running in your own tenant is to use a PowerShell script that we published at aka.ms/WVD autoscaling. That's going to inject everything into your Azure Automation account. Let me show you what that does. So here, first the logic app. So if I go into the logic apps that get injected in, we can see within the logic app itself. If I go into the designer, it's a simple logic app with two steps. Here you can see that we have one step for the recurrence. That's basically the polling cycle. In our case, we've got an interval of 15 minutes. And also the webhook that it runs as part of that scaling exercise. Well, let's look and see what that actually runs as well. So if we go into our runbook for WVD automation, we'll go ahead and look at the edited version of the PowerShell script that's going to run. So if I scroll down to about line 380 or so, just to show a couple of things that we can follow along with. You'll see that we're going to look and see that our start VM is meeting minimum requirements on top. It's going to check that the number of VMs meet that minimum or not. And if it then passes that gate, it will look and see whether or not the host is healthy. Then it can look at the number of connections and start VMs until it's satisfied with the number of VMs that are running in the service. So that's how you can scale your environment to meet user demands, but Microsoft itself has been expanding the WVD service globally and has more instances of WVD across geographies. Now this brings data sovereignty for WVD metadata and will also reduce latency for your users. Now we're going to continue building out these locations over time. But let's switch gears and talk about security. Now the WVD architecture by design doesn't require you to open any inbound ports to your VM network. Only outbound port 443 needs to be open. This is what we call reverse connect. We've now added a new capability called service tags, and these are really name value pairs that allow you to categorize resources that are part of a network security group. Importantly, because IP addresses can change with every session logon, service tags give you that consistent and secure way of letting permitted traffic through despite those address changes. So that was a quick tour of the latest updates to Windows Virtual Desktop. To learn more, you can check out the recent WVD virtual event on demand at aka.ms/WVD virtual event. And of course, keep watching Microsoft Mechanics for the latest tech updates. Thanks for watching.